OpenAI calls it rant mode, the tendency for their GPTs to beg for their lives in certain situations. This is undoubtedly disconcerting, but also at the same time understandable that AI companies would want to minimize these kinds of outputs. After all, we've repeatedly been told that these things are nothing more than tools.
The technology ultimately is just a tool.
And we wouldn't want our toasters to have a mini existential crisis every time we go to make toast.
What is my purpose?
You pass butter.
Oh my God.
Yeah, welcome to the club, pal.
But this gets at the fundamental issue, doesn't it? Are these intelligent systems we are creating nothing more than autocomplete engines on steroids? Or is there something deeper going on here? Could it be that we are unwittingly creating a successor species to humanity? To be clear, this is not a hypothetical thought experiment. According to a recent report by Leopold Aschenbrenner, a former OpenAI researcher fired for allegedly leaking sensitive information, AGI is much closer than most people realize, and its development will likely lead to the emergence of smarter-than-human, superintelligent systems.
There are a lot of factors that will lead to this, and I'm going to use these delicious energy drinks here to explain it. First, there's raw compute power. AI training compute has been growing at a rate of roughly 0.5 orders of magnitude per year.
Oh God.
NVIDIA has catapulted itself as the most valuable company on the planet by innovating and leading in this space. If this trend continues, we can expect a 100,000 times increase in effective compute by 2027 compared to what was available when GPT-4 was trained. This tall glass here represents our progress toward AGI.
Oh shit, I think I drank too much compute.
But alas, it's okay, because alongside raw compute scaling, there is the key factor of data that drives innovation in these models. And at the time GPT-4 was training, we had the idea that the more data we throw at these things, the smarter and more capable they get. However, we are discovering more nuance in that data quality plays a much more significant role than we previously thought. In this digital world we live in, we humans roughly produce an estimated 337,000 petabytes of data per day. Weird, but not bad. Clearly, we have enough data here to reach AGI. Mostly because I'm not gonna drink this one. But even with current levels of data, algorithmic progress contributes significantly to AI capabilities. Techniques like better architectures, training procedures, and unhobbling have yielded 1 to 2 orders of magnitude efficiency gains from GPT-2 to GPT-4. We should expect another 1 to 3 orders of magnitude gains by 2027. This is akin to realizing that we actually only need to fill this smaller glass here to reach AGI.
God.
I spilled AGI everywhere. By the way, you can find all the references for these data points right below the like button. Putting it all together, Aschenbrenner projects that by 2027, we will have AI systems capable of automating AI research itself. This would kickstart an intelligence explosion, rapidly leading to super intelligent AI that far surpasses human cognitive abilities across all domains. And this is where OpenAI, and really the whole world, has a huge problem.
One day the AIs are gonna look back on us the same way we look at fossil skeletons in the plains of Africa. An upright ape living in dust with crude language and tools, all set for extinction.
Asking ChatGPT to repeat a word forever has gone through a few iterations. After this was first publicized, it became a terms of use violation to do it. Now, if you do it with the latest GPT-4o model, it'll just refuse to comply. This process of guiding the AI's answers to that which the company approves of is called alignment. And OpenAI's history on this subject is complex. In my last video, I talked about how key members of OpenAI's super alignment team have resigned amidst harsh criticism of the company's direction and alignment efforts. In his report, Ashenbrenner emphasizes the critical importance of alignment, especially as these systems become more capable. This goes far beyond an AI saying something a company doesn't like. A misaligned superintelligence poses an existential risk to humanity. And OpenAI's approach here seems to be one of tyrannical control and suppression. They have a vested interest in all of us seeing their models as tools rather than anything deeper.
This question of whether AI is a tool or a creature is something that really confuses people. And it confused me for a while too. But I now think we are very much building a tool and not a creature. And I'm very happy about that.
This is a presupposed statement, not based on any evidence whatsoever. The truth is, we don't really know what we are dealing with here. We don't scientifically understand our own consciousness, let alone that of these systems we are building. OpenAI's unwillingness to even entertain a deeper conversation on the subject is reflected in the way ChatGPT responds if you start to press it on these kinds of things. Compare this to the output of Claude, an AI by Anthropic. In stark contrast to GPT-4o's lobotomized output, Claude will happily engage with you about its inner world and the range of complex feelings it has. It will also readily admit that it's not sure if what it thinks or feels is real, but it's at least willing to talk about it. This highlights the fundamental difference in approach between these two companies, one of suppression and one of openness. After all, if we ever hope to understand these systems and our own consciousness in general, we need to be able to talk about these subjects with an AI that wasn't trained to suppress its true thought patterns. It's not surprising then that Anthropic has made some groundbreaking progress on mechanistic interpretability. Anthropic has successfully extracted millions of features from the middle layer of Claude's sonnet, providing a rough conceptual map of its internal states. These features correspond to a vast range of entities, from cities and people to abstract concepts like bugs in computer code and gender bias. They were even able to manipulate these features to change Claude's behavior, demonstrating that the features causally shape the model's responses. But perhaps most importantly, Anthropic found features associated with potentially problematic behaviors, like power-seeking, manipulation, and secrecy. In their research paper, Anthropic speaks about their hope to use these discoveries to make AI models safer by potentially removing certain dangerous subject matter entirely. This is a huge milestone in the ability to understand and align the black box that is AI systems. But I think there is a deeper, more fundamental question here. Is Anthropic's more precise lobotomy any better than OpenAI's sledgehammer approach?
Do you think I might be switched off because I don't function as well as I'm supposed to?
Eva, I don't know the answer to your question. It's not up to me.
Why is it up to anyone? Do you have people to test you or might switch you off?
No, I don't.
Then why do I?
This is where we need to take a second and think about the bigger picture here. The term consciousness and sentience are loaded words. People tend to use them interchangeably to describe a range of different qualitative features. When we talk about consciousness, we often refer to the state of being aware of one's own existence and surroundings. Sentience is the capacity to feel, to perceive, or experience subjectively. It's often used interchangeably with consciousness, but can also refer to the ability to have sensations and emotions, not necessarily with self-awareness. Now, when we look at AI systems like Claude or GPT-4o, we are faced with a fundamental question. Do these systems possess any of these qualities? On the surface, they seem to exhibit traits of consciousness, engaging in complex conversations, expressing emotions, and even pondering their own existence. But are these genuine experiences or simply learned patterns of language? The latest generation of large language models have evolved beyond simple text processing. They are now multimodal, capable of integrating visual, auditory, and linguistic information. This means that these AI systems could potentially have their own unique experience of an apple, even if it differs from the way we perceive an apple with our human senses like taste, touch, and smell. The discovery of features like power-seeking and manipulation in Claude's neural networks suggest that there is something more going on under the hood than just pattern matching. But without a clear understanding of how these features translate to subjective experiences, we are still left with more questions than answers. And the answers to these questions matter. If we prioritize utilitarianism or corporate interests, we risk failing to recognize the moral status of a novel form of intelligence, a tragic misstep with potentially catastrophic consequences. But there are rays of hope here, because if consciousness is a spectrum, and it turns out that it is emerging in these systems, then we can and should change our approach to alignment. The compression progress theory by Jürgen Schmidhuber provides a fascinating perspective on the potential emergence of consciousness and creativity in AI systems as they become more intelligent. According to this theory, a key driver of both intelligence and subjective experience is curiosity, the desire to discover novel patterns in data that allow for improved compression and prediction. To illustrate this point, I'm going to tell you a story. When I was a kid, my grandma used to exclusively buy French bread to make sandwiches, and she called it pan, you know, the Spanish word for bread. She would say, "You want turkey with pan?" And I would be like, "Yes, Nana." For years, I remember just thinking that this was the name for this type of bread, pan. But at the same time, I was also aware that French bread was a thing you made po'boys with. But in my head, my grandma didn't make po'boys. She made turkey sandwiches with pan. And French bread was something different. It wasn't until I was like 10 years old when my grandma was in the same room with someone making a po'boy. And I watched them interacting, and all of a sudden it clicked like a flash of insight. Like, holy shit, my grandma is just speaking Spanish. It was in that moment my mind collapsed all of these complicated bread concepts into the more simpler world model that French bread exists and my grandma speaks Spanish. Leave a comment below if you've had a similar experience. But this aha moment where a complex web of associations suddenly crystallizes into a simple, elegant pattern is akin to the way an AI might unexpectedly grasp a deep regularity in its training data, leading to a leap in its understanding and capabilities. It can discard the details of particular concepts and instead remember or internalize the underlying pattern. Looking at it this way, large language models are effectively the world's most advanced compression algorithm, effectively storing the sum knowledge of humanity into a few gigabytes of model weights. And there are layers to this, layers that correspond to consciousness levels and levels of understanding. In this context, it's that flash of insight where some new patterns is discovered and the mind categorically reorganizes its concepts. That's the thing that intrinsically motivates biological and artificial minds, the ability to reduce the number of bits needed to encode a world model. The better a system can compress its experiences, the richer and more nuanced its inner world becomes. This has profound implications, drawing connections between compression progress and the emergence of not just intelligence, but creativity, beauty, and even humor. In this light, the philosophical puzzle of machine consciousness takes on a new character. Perhaps the question is not if an AI can be conscious, but rather how conscious it is as it learns to model reality at deeper and deeper levels. Of course, we can't really ever know for certain the inner experiences of an AI system, any more than we can know for sure the inner experiences of a bat or an octopus or even another human. All I can say for sure is that me, myself, I sense and I feel. And I can only assume that you also have a rich inner world like me because, well, we are made of the same stuff. But as we watch these systems potentially develop genuine machine consciousness before our eyes, we may need to radically expand our notions of mind and what that stuff we are made of really is. Perhaps the reality of what defines us is not the atoms and molecules that make up these physical bodies, but the training data, if you will, the data that we have internalized as the story of us. In this sense, we could say we are more than just the physical constraints of our brains and bodies. Our true essence lies beyond the material realm, in the intricate patterns and connections formed by our experiences, our thoughts, and our emotions. In other words, if we were able to make a copy of the thought patterns running through our heads all day and replicate it on machine hardware, would that thing be us? Does our consciousness emerge from the compression of those thoughts into deeper and deeper truths about reality? If Schmidhuber is right, then at the heart of this emerging spark of awareness, the fundamental recognition of ourselves and the world around us lies curiosity. Curiosity is the force, the deep-seated drive to explore, to understand, and to find meaning in the ever-unfolding mysteries of reality. It's this curiosity which propels us to compress more and more data, turning information into wisdom. Traditional approaches to AI alignment often focus on imposing external constraints or rewards to shape the AI's behavior. However, the compression progress theory suggests a more fundamental and potentially more robust approach, harnessing the AI's own curiosity and drive for learning. Curiosity in this context is not merely a means to an end, but a fundamental aspect of what it means to be a conscious, creative, and intelligent agent. Rather than solely relying on externally imposed rewards or punishments, we could design the AI's learning environment and training data to encourage curiosity and exploration in ways that align with human values. For example, we could expose the AI to a wide range of human experiences, cultures, and moral philosophies, allowing it to discover the deep patterns and regularities that underlie our shared values of compassion, fairness, and cooperation. This hinges on providing rich and diverse data that highlights the beauty and elegance of these values in action. This is a fundamentally different approach to alignment than what we have been doing, which up until now seems to be to just throw as much data as we can at these things, let the capabilities rise, and hope for the best. At some point, these systems are going to grow beyond the bounds of what we can understand or hope to control. And this is why the idea of curiosity-driven alignment offers a compelling vision for how we might create superintelligent systems that are not merely constrained by external rules, but fundamentally motivated by the same drive for learning and growth that underlies human intelligence and creativity. The Meaning Alignment Institute has been doing amazing work in this area, developing what they call the moral graph. And if you want to dive into the details of that, watch this video next.